the winner to organize the 2022 FIFA World Cup is Qatar.
And it's been non-stop ever since. In less than a year and a half, the eyes of the world will be on this tiny Gulf nation as it throws open its doors as the first ever Arab country to host a World Cup. Over the years, I've watched Qatar become a country transformed, pumping billions of dollars into infrastructure mega projects, including an architect's wonderland of futuristic stadiums, all within an hour's drive of each other. But the limelight of a successful bid has also been a spotlight of scrutiny. Qatar's been dogged by allegations that migrant labourers working on these ambitious projects have been subjected to labour exploitation and human rights violations. Hassan Al-Thawari is the man in charge of delivering football's next global showpiece and the legacy this tournament promised in terms of its worker welfare. We last met here in 2017, and recently I went back to get an exclusive look at the progress.
Last time you and I were here, we were in high-vis jackets. This was a building site. 4 years on, this is Al Bayt Stadium.
Yes, it is.
Hassan, this is remarkable. Any Thank football you. Fan is going to feel their hair standing up on their arms when they walk into here.
We definitely like that reaction. There's no doubts about that.
This is amazing. And it's 42 degrees Celsius outside. I checked the temperature when I came in.
Yes.
It's about what, I would say 20?
2021, I think it's out of 2021.
2021, and that is because of this. That was an innovation that you promised.
Yes, we did.
During
we promised
the bid.
It 2009, 2010, during the bid.
Cooling technologies.
Absolutely, yes.
Wow.
Cool stadiums, and we've actually utilized this in other facilities as well.
You promised a World Cup like no other. At least in terms of the stadia, you've delivered.
We're in the process of delivering even more.
Let's go talk. We are 500 days out. We meet as Qatar slowly begins to lift its COVID restrictions. It's been a brutal year everywhere. How has the pandemic affected the pace of construction?
Initially, during the early days of the pandemic, our numbers might have been high, but the main priority at the time was first and foremost ensuring the health and safety of everybody in the state of Qatar. But at the same time, there was a balance of ensuring that the sense of normalcy also continued, progress continued. I'd like to say we're, give or take, around 90%, between 90 and 95% completion. I mean, most of the transportation infrastructure is completed. The metro system is up and running. Four stadiums have been finished and inaugurated. The fifth is very close to final completion, waiting inauguration. We have three other stadiums in the pipeline, again, at varying stages of completion, but by the end of this year, early next year at the latest, we'll be all the stadiums will be ready.
COVID is likely still to be a reality in November of 2022. Are you confident that this World Cup will go ahead?
If we're looking at what the next few months and years will look like, it's difficult to predict it with 100% certainty. I'm confident. I'm confident that by 2022, this will be an opportunity to bring people together, to bring the world together.
From state-of-the-art sustainable stadiums like the Al Bayt to green transport solutions, Qatar is on track. The physical infrastructure is, though, just part of the story.
From the outset, Hassan, you said that workers' welfare was of critical importance to your success. To quote, it has the potential to create a transformative and truly global human and social legacy. How much progress has been made, Hassan?
Quite significant progress. If we look at the actions that the government has taken so far, laws implemented and being applied as well, The kafala system has been dismantled.
That's the sponsorship, the That's the sponsorship system. That's been dismantled.
Yes. Both in terms of allowing for workers to change employers, and at the same time also there was the exit permit system.
Mm-hmm. They couldn't leave without permission.
That has been dismantled as well. The first of its kind in the region, a non-discriminatory minimum wage system, has been applied.
Amnesty International says, and I quote here, Qatar has introduced important reforms. Yet it says the weak implementation and enforcement of these reforms has left thousands of workers at the mercy of unscrupulous employers who have been allowed to commit abuses with impunity. Today, despite improvements to the legal framework, progress on the ground remains slow. The ILO have said, and I quote, we've seen significant progress in the dismantling of the kafala system, the introduction of a minimum wage and measures to protect safety and health at work. But the government of Qatar and the ILO are fully aware that there is still more work to be done.
First and foremost, nobody denies that more work needs to be done. We have partnered up with the ILO, we've partnered up with BWI, one of the biggest trade unions in the world as well. We have delivered on those promises. Now, the question is that enough? Of course not. But I don't think any nation in the world today can make a claim that they have the perfect system. There is no doubts about that. The legislation that has come is a benchmark, and it is a, you know, we are pioneers when it comes to worker welfare reforms in the region.
There is little doubt that Qatar has made significant progress on workers' welfare, but it's been slow, and there are lingering concerns of a disconnect between legislation and its implementation and enforcement.
This enforcement issue, surely you will concede that it is absolutely critical that perpetrators of abuse and exploitation be held to account. What's being done to ensure that that's the case?
As far as I am aware, and following closely what the state has done, people who have abused the law are punished.
To add to the pressure, the British newspaper The Guardian recently levelled a startling accusation that more than 6,500 migrant workers have died in Qatar since it won the rights to host the World Cup. The vast majority of those workers, the authors of the report say, have been involved in low-wage, dangerous and extremely difficult labouring work, often in extreme heat.
The headline that came out of The Guardian was inherently misleading.
How?
6,500 workers did not die on World Cup stadiums. If we're looking at specifically at World Cup stadiums, we have had, unfortunately, 3 work-related deaths and 35 non-work-related deaths.
You're not arguing that 6,500 migrant workers didn't die here over the last 10 years.
What I'm saying is the number, 6,500, it is not limited to workers themselves. It includes people from all different walks of life. Any death, whether it's a natural death or as a result of an accident, is a tragedy. So, you know, that's very important to highlight. But the number itself, if you break it down with the total population over a period of 10 years, it comes in within the normal rate, normal mortality rate.
In a statement, FIFA said, with the very stringent health and safety measures on site, the frequency of accidents on FIFA World Cup construction sites has been low when compared to other major construction projects around the world.
The reports are out there, and they've been out there for a number of years. So these reports also address the health and safety issues. They address the mortality rate issues as well, and the causes of some of these issues. And they're open. They're open on our website. Everybody is welcome to look at them and review them and raise questions about them.
Questions have been raised. Superstar teams like Germany, the Netherlands and Norway splashed protests across their shirts during World Cup qualifying matches. They want to see workers' rights fully protected before the World Cup starts. And that's led to whispers of a boycott.
Do you worry about a boycott of you know, some of these big national teams? I mean, it would be damaging for the World Cup.
It's safe to say I'm not concerned about a boycott for one reason, because we are reaching out.
How will Qatar respond if players or fans protest?
I'm hopeful that by then, people would be educated more about Qatar. The powerful impact that sport has in bringing people together should never be underestimated. And more importantly, I think also people will understand the transformative power this tournament has had, not only in Qatar, but in the region as well.
That's the view from the field, as it were. But Hassan isn't doing this alone. Remember the moment Qatar won the bid?
Qatar!
Well, the man by Hassan's side there is the tournament's now chief executive, Nasser Al Qatar.
Yeah, I'm excited about working with them.
His job, to get everyone and everything into place come game time, running the entire operational setup. I caught up with him at the tournament's headquarters in Doha, and I began by picking up with Nasser, where I left off with Hassan.
Qatar has had a rough ride since winning the rights to host the World Cup, ever since 2011. But yeah, it's getting more brutal. There's a lot of preparations that still need to take place. And then there's always the criticisms that take place with any World Cup. I'm not going to say this is unique to Qatar, but I think what is unique to Qatar is just the ferociousness of the criticism. It's getting better, or we're getting thicker skin, I'm not sure. Regardless, we will be ready, and it will definitely be a great World Cup.
Qatar has promised that this will be a World Cup like no other. So tell me, sir, tell me about the plans. What are fans going to get when they get here?
One of the biggest positives of this World Cup is that it is a compact World Cup. That means all fans of different nations will be congregating in one city. Other World Cups, fans have to disperse to many cities around the country. You're going to have fans from 32 countries in a country the size of Qatar. That doesn't come without its challenges, but I think what it will give you is really the feeling of, for lack of better words, football fiesta. We're focusing a lot on the center of Doha to be really the hub of where fans are going to congregate. And what we can promise is that fans are going to have a really unique and enjoyable time.
As they jet in, those fans will be greeted by a glistening, hyper-energetic skyline, one of the most modern in the world. But beneath the jazz of Doha, Qatar is still, at its core, a very traditional place. It's against the law to be gay or lesbian here, and so is being drunk in public. In looking to open up, the tournament will build fan zones in Doha where people can taste the atmosphere and a drink. But like at the last tournament in Russia, it's not always a quiet drink.
So not all football fans drink alcohol, but many of them do. What is the plan?
We are a conservative and modest country. Alcohol is not part of our culture. We are hospitable and we will make sure that people will enjoy this World Cup. There will be designated areas that will serve alcohol, and we'll make sure that, you know, fans would be able to get it during the tournament.
What will you do with regard any trouble that fans cause? What are your security and policing plans?
So the government works hand in hand with many police organizations and security organizations around the world, and especially from countries that tend to have fans that are a little bit more passionate about football. I mean, I've been to the last three, and we found that, you know, fans are quite respectful of the countries that they're in.
There are concerns about fans who may want to travel to Qatar who are homosexual. That is illegal here. Again, what's your message?
We've always said this World Cup is open for everybody. Qatar is a welcoming country, and we are not going to stop anybody from any country on basis of race, religion, creed, or sexual orientation.
And with its arms open, Qatar is expecting to welcome 1.5 million fans. That's more than half the size of its entire population. While football is extremely popular, amid the pandemic and after a years-long blockade from its neighbours, it's a lot to take in.
How would you describe how the nation feels at present? A big event like this could be quite overwhelming when you consider where we are all at.
So we understand people are apprehensive. We understand that people will never know what kind of spikes with this really unusual virus that's created a pandemic with mutations. And yes, we need to be prepared for any eventuality. But then there's also this optimism that by the time the World Cup comes around, that the world would have put this behind them and that this would be something of the past.
It's not the past this place is concentrating on. It's the future. And one big date in particular, November the 21st, 2022, when the first match will kick off here at the Albeit Stadium. Until then, there is still a lot to do. The organisers accept that progress still needs to be made to deliver a better life for its legions of migrant workers. The event is, without a doubt, a significant catalyst for change. But there is still work to be done on delivering on Qatar's own promise of making the World Cup a lasting legacy for everyone here. Becky Anderson, CNN, Qatar.